Good morning, PYC. Kamusta kayo? God is good?
All the time.
All the time?
God is good.
Before we start, let us ask the Lord to speak with us. Let us bow down our heads as we pray. Gracious God, our Heavenly Father, tell us, Lord, what to do today. Speak in the inner chambers of our hearts. Tell us, Lord, what to do. And help us, Heavenly Father, to understand your everlasting gospel. And we pray, Heavenly Father, that we will not only understand, but act according to what you want us to do today. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for the presence of the Holy Spirit and for the promises that is going to be fulfilled today. In Christ's worthy name, we pray. The title of my message this morning is The Everlasting Gospel. Kita niyo ba? The title of the message is Everlasting Gospel. What is the Everlasting Gospel? What is the Everlasting Gospel? Now let me share to you the theme of the John Conference these 5 years. It's called Reach the World. Reach up to God, reach in with God, and reach out with God. Reach up to God, reach in with God, and reach out with God. And let me read the mission statement of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. This is the mission statement. The mission of the Seventh-day Adventist Church is to call all people to become disciples of Jesus Christ, to proclaim the everlasting gospel embraced in the three angels' messages of Revelation chapter 14, verse 6 to 12, and to prepare the world for Christ's soon return. Pagka tinanong kayo, bakit kayo Seventh-day Adventist? Maraming sumasagot, para po maligtas. So pag hindi Seventh-day Adventist, hindi maliligtas. Well, ito yung mission ng Seventh-day Adventist. The Seventh-day Adventist Church is to call all people to become disciples of Jesus Christ. To proclaim. Bakit natin i-call ang mga people? From every denomination, to call them to proclaim the what? The everlasting gospel embraced in the three angels' message of Revelation chapter 14, verse 6 to 12. And to prepare the world for Christ's soon return. So dalawa yung task natin. The proclamation of the three angels' message of Revelation chapter 14, verse 6 to 12. And to prepare the people of God for the second coming. And what is our method? In harmony with the Bible's revelations, Seventh-day Adventist Seventh-day Adventists see as the climax of God's plan the restoration. In harmony with the Bible revelation, Seventh-day Adventists see as the climax of God's plan the restoration of His creation to full harmony with His perfect will and righteousness. So what is our method? Guided by the Bible and the Holy Spirit, Seventh-day Adventists pursue the mission through Christ-like living, Christ-like communicating, Christ-like discipling, Christ-like teaching, healing, and serving. So what are these? First is living, communicating, discipling, teaching, healing, and serving. So these are the methods that we employ in order to fulfill our mission. Now again, let's see the Seventh-day Adventist mission statement. In a special sense, Seventh-day Adventists have been sent in the world as watchmen and light bearers. So we do not become Seventh-day Adventists in order to be saved, but more than to be saved, we are watchmen and light bearers. To them has been entrusted the last warning for a perishing world. On them is shining wonderful light from the Word of God. And let us look how Ellen White says it. In Testimonies, Volume 1, page 19 and 20, it says, the Seventh-day Adventist mission statement, she said, they have been given a work. Who have been given a work? Who has been given a work? The Seventh-day Adventist has been given a work of most solemn import. Of the most solemn import. The proclamation of the first, the second, the third angel's messages. There is no other work of so great importance. They are to allow nothing else to absorb their attention. So we have been given a work with a solemn import. The proclamation of the first, second, and the third angel's message. And we are not to allow anything that would absorb us or absorb our attention. So what do you mean by sanctification? Sanctification, in the very simplest form or term, is focus. There are many things that we do in our life so that we are not successful in one thing because of the many things that we do. In order for us to be successful, we must be eye single to the glory of God. And as a Seventh-day Adventist, we must be eye single to the one mission that God has entrusted us before the coming of the Lord. And this is the faithful proclamation of the three angels' message. Now, the question is, what are the three angels' message? What are the three angels' message? The three angels' message are recorded in Revelation chapter 14, verse 6 to 12. And could you remember the three angels' message? Beginning from 6, what does it say? And I saw another angel flying in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to be preached to all nations, kindred, tongue, and people, saying with a loud voice, fear God, and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment has come, and worship him that made the heavens, the earth, and the springs of water. And the second message was what about? Babylon. Babylon is fallen. And let us see one by one. See, let me give you a little background of the three angels' message. The three angels' message has three messages. The first message of the first angel was a command. The second message was a call. And the third message was a caution. See, at first he says, it's a command. It says, fear God, the first command. Give glory to him, the second imperative. And worship him, the third imperative. These are all commands that ought to be followed. So if we are a commandment-keeping people, we ought to follow this command. And what are these? Fear God, give glory to him, and the hour of his judgment has come, and worship him. These three ought to be followed and obeyed. Fear God, give glory, and worship. We all know that fearing God means to follow his commandments, the Ten Commandments. According to Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 13, it says, this is the conclusion of the matter. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the whole man. If you want to be whole, keep his commandment. Now the second was give glory to him. And we know that giving glory to God means to what? To take care of our body temple. To do whatever is pleasing to God, whatever we do. See, it says, whatever you do, whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do it for the glory of God. Do it for Christ's character so that we could characterize or manifest the character of God. The third is what? Worship him that made the heavens, the earth. And we all know that in order to worship the Creator and the Redeemer, we ought to keep the Sabbath holy. And these are the three imperatives or the three commands. But we also have to do something. Not only obeying, not only doing what God wants us to do, but we also have to what? To heed the warning, the call. Babylon has fallen. He who what? Makes all nations drink of the wine of her fornication. So we ought to keep all these people from drinking the wine of fornication, from all sorts of what? Doctrines and practices that are against God. So we also have the work of warning the people. But at the end, we also have to caution the people that if they don't do the first imperative, the second imperatives, or the second angel's message, that they ought to caution themselves. Why? Because the Bible says, he who drinks of the wine of the wrath of God, that he who... Now, what was the third angel's message? If you have the mark of the beast and his image, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God without mixture. So these three must be faithfully done by Seventh-day Adventists. We are watchmen of God. First, we have to tell them what to do. Second, we have to caution them to go away from Babylon, because Babylon has fallen. Go out of her, my people. But if they don't do, we ought to tell them the ultimatum that God has prepared for them, because they are going to receive the wine of the wrath and the wrath of God, the cup of the wrath of God without mixture. If they don't do this, seven plagues are coming, and nobody can save you from God's wrath. Now, one particular in this three angels' message is the first angel carrying the everlasting gospel. And let me read it from Tagalog. It says, at nakita ko, narito sa isang alapap na maputi, sorry. At nakita ko ang isang anghel na lumilipad sa gitna ng langit na may mabuting balita na walang hanggan upang ipabalita sa mga nanahan sa lupa at sa bawat bansa ang kanat wika at bayan. So I saw another angel flying in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to be preached to all nations, kindred, tongue, and people. Now, what is the everlasting gospel? What is the everlasting gospel? According to Revelation chapter 14, verse 14, let me read it. At nakita ko at narito ang isang alapaap na maputi, at nakita ko na nakaupo sa alapaap na ang isang katulad ng isang anak na tao, na sa kanyang ulo ay may isang putong na ginto, at sa kanyang kamay ay may isang panggapas na matalas. What was the context of the three angels' message? In verse 6, it talks about the first angel's message. In verse 8, it talks about what? It talks about Babylon has fallen. In verse 9 and 10, it talks about what? The judgment of the Lord to those who do not believe and do not heed to the counsel of the true witness. But in verse 12, it says, here the patience of the saints that keep the commandments of God and has the faith of Jesus. In verse 14, it's the coming of the Lord. Meaning the three angels' message is the last message ever to be preached to all the world before the coming of God. Amen? Now, if this is the last message that is going to be brought all throughout the world, what ought we to do with this message? What ought we to do with this message? There should be nothing that should consume or absorb the people of God from this message. This must be proclaimed. This is God's command. Why? Because in Matthew chapter 24 says, and this gospel of the kingdom shall be preach to all the world as a witness to all nations, and then the end shall come. So the only thing that keeps us or keeps God from not returning is the proclamation of the gospel of the three angels' message. Unless it is proclaimed to all the world, kindred, people, tongue, and nation, the end shall not come. So what ought we to do with this gospel? What ought we to do with this gospel? And let me tell you, what are the consequences of heeding to this gospel? Or which I say, what are the rewards of heeding to this gospel? And what are the consequences of not heeding to this gospel? Whether actively or passively. Whether you would receive it or you would share it. If you would receive it, what is the consequence? If you would share it, what are the consequences? Now, let's not talk about the medium, let's just talk about the message yet first. And later I will be telling you the medium. In Revelation chapter 14, verse 10. Revelation chapter 14, verse 10. Please open your Bible, please. And I hope you would always carry your Bibles wherever you come to this place, because the Bible is the only guide that can guide us to the truth. Let us see. Revelation chapter 14, verse 10 says, He himself shall also drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out full strength in the cup of his indignation. He shall be tormented with fire, brimstone, and presence of the holy angels and in the presence of God. Now let me interpret a little bit of this. What are the things that we ought to remember here in verse 10? In verse 10 it says, he shall think also drink. Take note of the word drink or iinom. Did you see it? Ay iinom din naman siya ng alak ng wrath, kagalitan ng Diyos, na nahahandang walang halo sa cup, sa inuman. Whenever you think about drink, wrath, and cup, what comes to your mind in Revelation? The cup of her fornication. The cup of her fornication. So, whoever shall have the mark of the beast in his image shall receive of the wine of the wrath of God, of the wrath of God in the cup of his own indignation. So in Matthew chapter 26 verse 20, it says, nang magkagayoy sinabi niya sa kanya, namamanglaw ng lubha ang kaluluwa ko hanggang sa kamatayan, mga tira kayo rito, mga puyat sa akin. You know, in the night, Ellen White says, we want to contemplate on the glory of God, we always have to remember and go back to the solemn night when Christ has volunteered, gave himself on the cross, on that solemn night in Gethsemane. Jesus was saying, ano sabi ni Kristo? Namamanglaw na lubha ang kaluluwa ko. And why is he sad? Why is he so sad? Hanggang sa kamatayan. He was so sad unto death. Why? Because at that solemn night, something is going to happen. Hanggang sa kamatayan, mga tira kayo rito at mga puyat sa akin. See, you remain here and then watch with me, pray with me. The disciples didn't even know that it was a very solemn night. That it would cost the life of Christ in order to what? To redeem the whole earth. But they didn't know that that was a very solemn night. So in Matthew chapter 26 verse 39 says, at lumakad siya sa dako paroon, at siya'y nangagpatiraba at nanalangin at nagsabi, anak ko, ama ko, kung baga maari ay lumampas sa akin ang sarong ito. Nakikiusap, kung pwede lang, if it is possible. So Jesus Christ was what bargaining with his Father, saying, Lord, if it would be possible that this cup would pass from me. And remember the word cup. He was talking about that cup that would pass from him. And he said, gayon may huwag ang ayon sa ibig ko, kundi ang ayon sa ibig mo. And he was not telling about his own will. He was looking forward to the will of God, if it would be possible, and if it is your will, Heavenly Father, that this cup would pass from me. Nevertheless, I do not presume that it would be my will, only through your will. You know, in bargaining, at first you would what? You would insist what you wanted, or at least you would want to do what you wanted. But at the first and the second term of bargaining, it says, muli siyang umalis na bilang ikalawat na nalangin, ama ko, kung hindi mangyayari na makalampas ito. So what was the difference? Ang una sabi niya, kung pwede. Ano pang nangliligaw ka? Yan ang diskarte mo, kung pwede. Pero kapag medyo dihato ka na, kung hindi pwede. So Jesus Christ was trying to say, he was talking to the Father and pleading for the rest of his life. All his prayers was answered except the prayer of this solemn night. Jesus Christ was asking, if it is not possible, let your will be done. So Jesus Christ was trying to accept now that his doom is near. At first he was pleading with God. He was, you know, he was bargaining with God. But at this time, it was in the process of acceptance. And soon after he would accept, he would be totally condemned by God to death. And he would drink the cup that is supposed to be ours. Amen? That is supposed to be ours. At muli siyang iniwan at umalis at nanalangin bilang ikatlo at sinabi muli ang gayon sa kanyang mga salita in Hebrews chapter 5 verse 7 nang siya sa mga araw na kanyang laman ay nagandog ng mga panalangin at mga daing na sumisigaw ng malakas at lumuluha doon sa may kapangyarihan sapagkat sa kanya sa kamatayan at siya'y dininig dahil sa kanyang banal na takot. Now Jesus Christ was praying for two things. First, He was praying for you and me that we would all be saved. But at the same time, it was shaken because He was also praying for Himself. The human nature was what? Was a little bit floating. You know, there's a conflict between a human nature and God's nature. See, Ellen White was telling that the cross was the intersection between God's will and man's will. It would always intersect with each other. One was vertical, one was horizontal. It would always conflict. But during this time, when shaking was done, Jesus Christ was almost what? Almost overcome by His own personal feelings. But it would not be feelings. His compassion towards all of us, His love for all of us is what? Is powerful in order for Him to submit. And in Luke chapter 22, verse 44, at nang siya'y nanlulumo, ay nanalangin siya ng lalong maningas, at ang kanyang pawis ay naging gaya ng malalaking patak ng dugo na nagsitulo sa lupa. And because of His what? Stress, even blood flowed like a sweat in His own brows. Jesus Christ was agonizing. Jesus Christ was struggling, and He was not only thinking about Himself, He was thinking of the whole world. If only one soul is going to accept Him, why wouldn't He give His life for one soul as you are? If you needed His soul, if you needed His sacrifice, Jesus' trembling soul, nobody was praying for Him. Everybody slept. But Jesus was praying for Himself. And during that time, He struggled a lot. In John chapter 18, verse 11, at sinabi niya ni Jesus kay Pedro. And during that time, Jesus was struggling. And when He finally accepted the call for sacrifice, immediately the guards came and struck by Peter struck the what? The ear. One ear of the foe. And what happened? Jesus Christ touched the ears and said to Peter, Pedro, isalong mo ang iyong tabak. Ang sarong sa akin na ibinigay ng aking ama ay hindi ko magaling inumin. Keep your knives. Wouldn't I drink the cup that God has intended for me? You know, whenever you think about cup in the scripture, it always tells about the portion. Amen? Pagka nagtatagayan na, sabi niya, friend, ikaw na. Sabi niya, pass, friend. It's your portion now. But when it comes to Jesus Christ, He was supposed to drink this, but the cup trembled because of the struggle from within. The thinking was, why would I save these people who have not even prayed for me, who does not even care, who does not even are not worth, you know, dying for? Maybe Ninoy Aquino would say Filipinos are worth dying for. But what about human beings? Are we really worth dying for? He was not looking about our worthiness. He was looking about what He can do for us and what we can become if we would accept the everlasting gospel. Amen? If we would accept the everlasting gospel in John chapter 8 verse 29, at ang nagsugo sa akin ay suma sa akin, hindi niya ako binayaang nag-iisa sapagkat ginagawa ko lagi ang bagay na kanyang kinalulugod. See, He who sent me will not keep me alone. He would always be with me because I do the things that He wanted me to do. But this time, Jesus Christ, as He submitted Himself, as our substitute, become God's enemy. Matthew chapter 27 verse 46, at nang makalapit na sa oras na ikasyam ay sumigaw si Jesus ng malakas na tinig, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. Si God, Jesus Christ has never been alone. Jesus Christ has never been separated from His Father. But at this time, He was crying out David's cry. Father, God, why hast thou forsaken me? And why wouldn't God forsake Jesus Christ? He has become a sinner as a substitute for you and me. From the time He submitted Himself, from the time He took of the substitution, God cannot anymore do anything. Because Satan is in charge with Jesus Christ. It was the solemn night, the dark night for tonight, but for that night, because that dark night is your dark night supposed to be. And that dark night is only intended for the seven last plagues of those who would not submit to the cup of Jesus Christ. He said, my God, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? In Romans chapter 8 verse 32 says, siya na hindi ipinagkait ang kanyang sariling anak, kundi ibinigay dahil sa ating lahat. Bakit hindi naman ibibigay sa atin ang walang bayad ang lahat ng mga bagay? If He did not keep His Son from us, why would He keep anything from us? Eternal life itself will be given if we accept His Son. According to the Desire of Ages 687, the sins of men weighed heavily upon Christ and the sense of God's wrath. What? The sense of God's wrath against sin was crushing His soul, His life. See, what was crushing the life of Jesus Christ? It was God's indignation. God is what? Against sin. And because Jesus Christ has become a sin for us, God has to crush Jesus Christ. His flesh has become our substitution. The Desire of Ages 690 says, the awful moment had come, that moment which was to decide the destiny of the world. The faith of humanity trembled in balance. And that solemn night, nobody even knew. That solemn night was the deciding factor whether we'd all be saved or not. But Jesus Christ thought, they didn't know about this. I was the only one who had the opportunity to understand this. And why would I keep salvation from them? If only that I could give myself to them, they would understand later that the life of sacrifice I gave would be the life of sacrifice they would give to others. Amen? And if you take me my death, and if they were willing to even die in order to save their fellow humankind in preaching the gospel, why not? Christ might have even now refused to drink the cup. He would even now refuse to drink the cup. And has all the privileges and right to refuse it. A portion for the guilty man, it was not yet too late. He could still recant or at least go back. He would say, leave them. The world was in Jesus' hand for that very hour. And yet the Desire of Ages 690 says he might wipe the bloody sweat from his brow and leave man to perish in its iniquity. He might say, let the transgressor receive the penalty of his own sin. Let them receive the sin. They have rejected me. And I will go back to my Father. Will the Son of God drink the bitter cup of humiliation and agony? He was worshipped in heaven by all the angels. He was served by all the angels. But in this earth, He was rejected by His own Israel, His own sons and daughters that He has what? So much cherished love. None, not even one, have come to comfort Him. Jesus was agonizing. And He was not just thinking about His disciples. He was thinking about you, me, your family, your neighbors. What killed Jesus Christ was the question. It was the sense of sin. bringing the Father's wrath upon him as man's substitute, that made the cup he drank so bitter. What made the cup so bitter? It was the sin of, and the God's wrath towards sin that made the cup so bitter that he couldn't even what? Drink it, because he was not used to drinking it. The consequences of our sin are now his, and he's volunteering himself and broke the heart of the Son of God. So what killed Jesus Christ? He died of a broken heart for you and me. What killed Jesus Christ? What killed Jesus Christ? In the passion of the cross, as if the physical agony killed Jesus Christ. In the passion of Christ, as if it was what? It was the blood that flowed out of from him that killed him. But in John chapter 10 verse 17, nobody can kill the Son of God. Amen? He has the power to give it. He has the power to take it up again. You cannot kill the Son of God. But it was the sin and the wrath of God. He died of a broken heart. Amen? He died of a broken heart so that we could abhor sin. So that we could reject sin rather than reject Christ. Galatians chapter 3 verse 13 says, sa sumpa ng kautusan ay tinubos tayo ni Kristo na naging sumpa sa ganang atin, sapagkat nasusulat, sinumpa ang bawat binibitay sa punong kahoy. And Jesus Christ was crucified not for our own curse, not for his own curse, but for ours. Jesus Christ voluntarily gave himself for our sin so that he becomes a curse and we become blessing. Amen? In 2 Corinthians chapter 5 verse 21 says, yaong hindi nakakilala ng kasalanan ay kanyang inaring may sala dahil sa atin upang tayo maging sa kanya'y katwiran ng Diyos. Tanong, si Jesus Christ ay inaring may sala. Tanong, nagkasala hindi? Yung pang inaring may sala, nagkasala hindi? Eh kung nagkasala, kailangan pa bang ariing may sala? So Jesus Christ was what? Jesus Christ was accounted sinner so that we could also be accounted as righteous. Isaiah chapter 53 says, tunay na kanyang dinala ang ating mga karamdaman, dinala ang ating mga kapanglawan, gayon may hindi pinalagay siya, gayon may ating pinalagay siya, hinampas, sinaktan ng Diyos. Sino nagsakit? Ang Diyos at dinalamhati. Ngunit siya'y nasugatan ng dahil sa ating mga pagsalangsang. Siya'y nabubog dahil sa ating mga kasamaan. Ang parusa na tungkol kanino? Sa ating kapayapaan ay nasa Kanya, at sa pamamagitan ng Kanyang mga latay ay nagsigaling tayo. He has suffered all things for us. Tayong lahat ay gaya ng mga tupa. Ano nangyari sa atin? Gaya tayo ng mga tupa na naliligaw, tayo'y tumungo bawat isa sa kanya sariling daan, at pinasan sa kanya ng Panginoon ang kasamaan nating lahat. Kanino ipinasan ang kasamaan nating lahat? Kay Christ. Jesus is our sin bearer. Jesus is our substitute. What ought to happen to us has already happened in Jesus Christ. Why? Because this is the gift from God. For the wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen? So what happened? There was a transaction in heaven that Christ's blood would be for us, and our death is for Jesus Christ. We have life, he would have death. This was the great transaction, and we call it the transaction of faith. In John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. Now let me ask you a question. If we would childishly interpret this text, who do you think has God loved so much? Was it his Son or the world? For God so loved the world. The other day, we had a survival camp, and one of the fathers came, and he's a pastor. And he couldn't, you know, keep himself, but he visits the child, and he would give food during the survival camp, because he couldn't keep himself from giving. He would always give his daughter some food. And he was there. And I just love the idea that a father cannot keep himself from giving. But this time, he kept himself because he wants to give all of us his son. Jesus is a gift from God. He kept himself. He agonizes with his son because he loved us so much. Now to end, there are a few texts I want to tell you. In Romans chapter 1 verse 16 it says, because I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God unto salvation, both for the Jews, then to the Gentiles. We are not ashamed of what? The everlasting gospel. Why would we be ashamed of the everlasting gospel? Whenever I preach Sabbath, I do not usually shout. Whenever I preach health, I do not usually shout. I do not have much power. You know, I would just tell you, the Sabbath is need to be God. But whenever Jesus Christ is preached, whenever the blood of Jesus Christ is preached, I shout to the top of my voice, because this is not something to be ashamed of. Amen. The blood of Jesus Christ that was spent for us is not to be ashamed of. We ought to be giving it to others because it is free. Because it is free. In Philippians chapter 3 verse 9 it says, At ako'y masumpungan sa kanya na walang katwiran sa aking sarili sa makatwid bagay sa kautusan, kundi sa katwiran sa pamamagitan ng pananampalataya kay Kristo, ang katwiran ng buhay sa Diyos. Because we do not have our own righteousness, we do not have our own righteousness according to the law. He gave His Son to become our own righteousness that we might be justified. And what is justified? When you are not just and you are justified, it is the grace of God. Now let me ask you a question. Can you justify something that is just? You cannot justify something that is just. You can only justify that which is not just. Why? Because Jesus has become our justification. He is our righteousness. We were made righteous because we are not righteous. He was made sinner, though he is a sinner. Martin Luther says that simul justus et peccator, meaning while we are sinners, we are also righteous. How? By faith. Do you have this faith that though you are sinners, you are righteous? If according to the law and according to works, we are not righteous. Am I right? But if it's according to faith and acceptance in Christ, we have become righteous in Him. Amen? We have become righteous in Him. And what does the Lord want this righteousness to be? Hindi mabagal ang Panginoon tungkol sa kanyang mga pangako, kundi matiyagat sa inyo na hindi niya ibig sino man ay mapahama. So God does not want to give righteousness only to few. He wants to give righteousness to all, that no one should perish. Now let me ask you a question. If you see a person who does not keep the law, or at least not religious, what would you think of him? Would you think of him as God's personal interest? Would you think of him that he, because of him, Christ died? What would you do with a person who has not known and accepted Christ and has become righteous by the blood of Jesus Christ? You would think of him as one that God would love to be saved. Amen? In Romans chapter 5 verse 19, sapagkat sa paano sa pamamagitan ng pagsaway ng isang tao, marami nga mga makasalanan, gayon may sa pamamagitan ng pagsunod sa isa, ang marami ay naging mga matuwid. Ano? Dahil sa pagkakasala ng isa, ilan ang nagkasala? Lahat ay naging makasalanan. Ano? Meron ba tayong ginawa para maging makasalanan? Did we do anything in order to become sinner? Did you do anything? No. It was in the account of Adam that we have been what? Made sinner. So if you have not done anything to become a sinner, would you do anything to become righteous? Could you do anything to become righteous? If you have not done anything to become a sinner, much more you cannot do anything to become righteous. It was through one man that we have become sinner. And it will be through a man, the second Adam, that we would become righteous. Amen. So proclaim this man to all people, nation, kindreds, and tongue, that he died for all that we might become righteous. Amen. That we might become righteous for by grace, for only by grace, undeserved grace, that we become righteous by faith, not of ourselves. It is a gift of God, not by any works this anyone should boast. At the end, I would like to quote with you a writer, and I would like to end up with this quotation. First, I would like to see the picture. A fireman calling for the man who is almost to be caught up in fire. And this man was what? Rejecting the salvation. See, today God wants you to offer all people even though they would reject. Amen. And today I would like you to contemplate on this image. The body of Jesus Christ in bread, and the blood of Jesus Christ in the wine. Jesus Christ, the night he was betrayed, said, take this cup and drink it. Why does Jesus Christ want us to take the cup? Because he's taking another cup that is supposed to be for us. And if we reject taking that cup, we are going to drink the cup prepared for us. But if we are going to take the cup of Jesus Christ, we are not going to take the cup prepared in the last days because of the wrath of God. Today, what would you do with this cup that you would drink from Jesus Christ? Would you share it to others or not? Last quotation from Spurgeon. Do you have no wish for others to be saved? Then you are not saved yourself. Do you have no wish for others to be saved? Then you are not saved yourself. Today, I would like you to give your enamor to God, your love for Him. I'm not asking you to accept Jesus Christ alone and His salvation and His cup. I want you to share this cup to others. Amen? Now, I would like to make clear and special appeal today sa harap ng ating youth director. And I have done this in Bataan, and I hope I could do it again today. Who among you here wants to proclaim the three angels' message and the everlasting gospel to your neighbor and to other places, and to be God's instrument of saving them? That's the first question. The second question is rather more, would take more of your faith. The Bible says, what is faith? Faith comes from hearing. Hearing the word that comes from Christ. But how could they hear? Let me read it to you. Oh, maganda, may mga convention na ganito. Maganda. Pero pagkatapos ito, ano? Pakinggan ninyo. Romans. No, I messed up now. Romans chapter 10. Is it 10? 10:17. How shall they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how shall they believe in whom, in him of whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? And how shall they preach unless they are sent? How beautiful are the feet of those who preach the gospel of peace, who bring glad tidings of good things, but they have not all obeyed the gospel. For Isaiah said, Lord, who has believed on our report? So then faith comes from hearing the word of God. The problem is this: how shall they accept if they have not heard? How shall they hear if nobody has preached? How shall they preach if nobody has been sent? Now, I have been praying for PYC since before I come here, and I've been praying for the real PYC and PYC Bicol. And my prayer is to send forth laborers. Now, this is a serious appeal now. And I want you to stand here. And as soon as you stand here, PYC is going to commit ourselves, our money, everything to train you and to send you as missionaries preaching the gospel. I would like to appeal, if you have been called by God, if you are called by God today or even before today to preach the gospel, no matter how young or old are you, would you like to stand if God is calling you to preach the gospel? I mean, preach the gospel. Speak before the people. Don't worry how you would do it. But if God is calling you today, would you like to stand? There's no special music, no special appeal, no appeal to emotion. Just let the Holy Spirit. But before you do so, let me pray for you. Gracious God, Heavenly Father, I know this is the most solemn appeal for today. But unless you move their hearts, they cannot move their feet. And I pray, Lord, and I'm asking, Heavenly Father, how could people believe if they have not heard? How could they hear if there is no preacher? And how could they preach if they have not been sent? Send therefore, Heavenly Father, co-laborers with Christ, so that they could preach the gospel to all the world and hear the tremendous message. In Christ's worthy name, I pray. Amen. Now, who among you here are being called by God to preach the gospel? Would you like to stand? You. There are many people who are needed in the field. First, the speaker for evangelism. The Bible speaker. Second is the health speaker for evangelism. Third is the speaker for children. And fourth is for those who will Bible study. Don't worry about the training. The Lord will equip those who He called. Now, don't stand if you're just thinking about it. But if you're convicted by the Holy Spirit to the minutest thoughts, do not resist. Sino sa inyo, and I will make it plain in Tagalog, sino sa inyo ang tinatawagan ng Panginoon para ipangaral ang pabalita? Ngayon, tinatawagan ka ng Panginoon na tumayo at ipasakop ang iyong paglilingkod sa Kanya na walang kalimdaman. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Lumapit po dito. Ito ang inyong nais. Pagkatapos po nito, ay kukunin namin ang inyong mga pangalan at i-include namin kayo sa malaking training na gagawin for evangelism. At kung paano yung gagawin yun, bahala na po. Please, come closer. Come closer. At this time, I would like to invite Pastor Franche to pray for these young people.
Maraming ito, Panginoon, pinapuri ka namin at pinapasalamatan sa napakalang misa namin narinig ang kalagahan ng Ebanghelyo na ipinagawa mo sa amin at ito rin dapat namin i-share sa mga tao na hindi pa nakakilala sa inyo. Pinapuri ka namin, Panginoon, sapagkat ang mga kabataan ito ay nagtuloy sa inyong panawagan. Nabasa mo ang kanilang mga puso sa Panginoon ang kanilang pagtatalaga. Ihintilin na yung oras na ito kundi sa mga tarapang parahan na sila yung papagamit sa inyo na dalhin ang mabuting balita ng Ebanghelyo ni Yesu Kristo sa mga tao upang sila rin ay may handa sa inyong malapit ng pagdating. Tulungan, Panginoon, ang mga kapatahan ito na ang kanilang pagtatalaga na magpatuloy hanggang ikaw dumating. Marami pa kami makasama dyan sa inyong karyan. Tulungan ang nagagawang activities dito sa namadawan namin ang kapag narinig ng Banal Espiritu upang ito'y aming maging kapangyarihan sa paglilingkod namin sa inyo. Salamat, Panginoon, sa pangalan ni Jesus. Amen.
So, mamaya po itong grupo na ito, during lunch, tatawagan po namin pabalik dito at makikipag-usap po kami sa inyo. Salamat.